Here in the land of the Jewish people, it is permitted to speak Hebrew and pray. It is permitted to celebrate the Jewish holidays. Here, at home, it is possible to live as a free Jew. In the communist USSR, it was not permitted to live as a Jew. The Soviet regime attempted to silence thousands of years of Jewish history and culture. Except for the activity of individuals, Soviet Jewry was voiceless. 1967, the Six-Day War. Jerusalem was reunified. The Western Wall was liberated. And in the USSR, a Jewish national revival began. Many Jews yearned to be part of the Zionist dream, to learn what it means to be a Jew. Groups and individuals gathered secretly to learn Hebrew and study Jewish history, to celebrate the holidays, to be proud Jews together, and to demand immigration to Israel. On May 15, 1970, a group of refuseniks, Jews who were denied the right to leave the USSR, in order to immigrate to Israel, tried to hijack an airplane and escape to the West. The KGB apprehended the group, and they were brought to trial. The brave stand of the accused proved that the awakening of Soviet Jewry had become a widespread national Jewish movement. Thousands of activists and refuseniks paid a costly personal price. They were persecuted and fired from their jobs, put on trial, and incarcerated for many years in prisons and labor camps. Around the world, Jewish communities rallied to show their solidarity. The struggle for the immigration of Soviet Jewry became the struggle of Jews worldwide. With the cry, "Let my people go," the Soviet Union was pressured to free the prisoners of Zion and to open its gates to the Aliyah of the Jews. In the 70s, the international protests and demonstrations began to bear fruit and bring about the loosening of the noose. Working behind the scenes, the Jewish Agency facilitated the emigration of tens of thousands of Jews, bringing them home to Israel. In the 80s, the Soviet regime stiffened its stand and stopped the stream of emigration. The Iron Curtain closed once again. With the decline of the Soviet regime towards the end of the 80s, cracks developed in the refusal front. And in 1989, after the renewal of formal relations with Israel, the Jewish Agency, with the support of UJA, Keren HaYesod, and its partners around the world, moved into immediate action as the gates of Aliyah opened wide. In 1989 and 90, prior to the commencement of direct flights to Israel, Jewish Agency emissaries built transit camps throughout Eastern Europe to facilitate mass Aliyah. And during the 90s, Jewish Agency offices were established throughout the vast FSU, working around the clock to bring more than 1 million Jews home. As Israel faced the daunting challenge of absorbing 1 million new immigrants, our partnerships, together with the government of Israel, established critical programs, from ulpans to Jewish identity courses to job retraining initiatives, to ensure their successful integration into Israeli society, contributing immensely to the country's prosperity and strength.
Why am I Israeli? I'm Israeli because I'm proud to be Israeli. Because in spite of all the wars and the conflict which built our reality, we Israelis are endowed with enormous vitality, liveliness, and desire for peace.
I feel Israeli because I'm a separated part of this nation, this culture, the Jewish history. Despite all the wars and the terrorism, I feel like there is no other place in the universe that I want to give birth to my children more than here.
I'm Israeli because I fell in love with this country the first second I came. I love Israel and I want to put my impact to bring more Jews to this country and to make them love it as I do.
I'm Israeli because I serve in the IDF and I care about this country. I'm Israeli because I respect and understand the people of this nation. I'm Israeli because I'm Jewish and I have no other land.